music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN music director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
With me is one of the great figures in music, Abram Chasins. Mr. Chasins has been so important to the world of music that to enumerate his achievements would be literally impossible in the two programs that we will be having. He is certainly in the realm of radio one of the most important figures of our time, and in many senses he is the creator of classical music on commercial radio. He for many years was the celebrated music director of WQXR. He is a composer, a modest composer who doesn't really like to talk about his own works, and he is a pianist of achievement. And we are going to, on this program, hear some of his music, and we are going to hear Mr. Chasins, the pianist. And the first thing that I want to say is congratulations on the sale of your Stokowski book, which this year has been out now almost a year, and it is really a big seller, and it's a wonderful biography.
Well, thanks very much, David. It does very well for a music book, but as you know, you have to write a book, well, on cooking or sex or violence, if you want. Really big sales.
Yes, even a personality on the level of a Stokowski can't make a bestseller out of a music book. One of the questions I want to ask you is, as a student of one of the great masters of the piano, Joseph Hoffman, you who adored his playing and worked with him so long, in your opinion, Abram Chasins, is there a decline in world pianism at this moment?
Well, it sounds carping and as though one had gotten too old to say a categorical yes to that interesting question. I think that some of the same values in music that have happened in the world have contributed to a certain loss in emotional intensity, in abject faith, in deep warmth and tenderness and love, which, of course, as we know, have all taken great, great losses throughout the world. The rise of vulgarity and things that assail our society today, the whole temper of the time is not a poetic one.
No.
And I think that is the big loss. One, I think that the average pianist today is infinitely more capable, infinitely more efficient, and plays much better, even musically and scholastically, than the average pianist of the past.
However, that titanship that Rachmaninoff and Hoffman had and Gudovsky had, these are pianists that you knew intimately, that you grew up with, and who formed your musical taste. And yet, as a critic, and anyone that wants to read a book of great importance on the piano must read your book, Speaking of Pianists, which I believe is out of print, but must not be out of print. Really, it's an important book.
Well, after 22 years, it has gone out of print, so I have no real complaints. I think it was remarkable for it to last that long, and I'm very grateful that it has. But what it was talking about mainly was the spiritual and emotional content of the great art of the great artists.
Yes, that's indeed true, and that's what makes this book of great humanist worth, and I hope that you add maybe a new chapter or a new preface and get that book back into print.
Well, I'm going to do it on another level, David. Mm-hmm. I'm giving a course this year at the University of Southern California called Making It in Music. It's really the anatomy of a career, and in it, I am going to talk at great length about the fact that there are certain principles of expressivity which are as inexorable as the law of accident, mm-hmm. and certainly as interesting and as obtainable as a fine mechanical technique.
Yes.
And that is something else that is very rarely spoken about.
Practically lost, I believe. Another aspect of your career which is not quite as known as the many other things you have done, is that you have taught quite a bit, almost as a secret career. Many great pianists, including a woman you know very well, studied and reaped great harvest from your ability. That is whom? Of course, Constance Keane, but there are so many others that have come to you for tutoring.
Well, the reason for that, David, is that I've had the luck of knowing a great many remarkable talents. And they were so remarkable that I could never consider them students, you see.
Yeah.
So they coached with me, or they asked me questions, or they lived around my world. Mm-hmm. And I had so much to tell them. Of course, they didn't come to me. They came to the me who was so close to Hoffmann and Rachmaninoff and Godowsky and Backhaus and Mozeevich and Rubinstein and Horowitz and everybody else you can mention of pianistic dimension.
You have known everyone, really.
Well, I've lived that long. Sheer longevity, David, and great luck.
You know, you're 77 and just full of youth. You know that, though.
Well, we know. Youth is a state of mind, not an age.
Now, the first works we will hear today are your own pieces of which you yourself really have forgotten. You're someone who literally lives in the moment. And the moment the piece was done, it's done. And I said, we're going to hear William Capel in a very rare performance of four of your works. And at this moment, we'll talk about him right after we hear him, but I'm so curious as to see the reactions. I'm sorry that the radio audience won't be able to have the reactions that I now will have from you in The Waltz of the Rainbow by the Brook, Dancing Bagpipes and Tricky Trumpet, in a rare performance by the late William Capel. The pieces by my guest, Abram Chasins.
Thank you.
Waltz of the Rainbow by the Brook, Dancing Bagpipes, and Tricky Trumpet, four of a group of children's pieces by my guest, Abram Chasins. And right after this message or two, we'll be right back. I'm back with Abram Chasins. Your face was absolutely a delight during this because you, indeed, each piece you, of course, recognized, but you had long forgotten them. You said Capel was a wonderful, wonderful pianist, and you might have dedicated one of those to one of his children.
Yes, well, they're children's pieces, you know. There were six of them, and one of them was dedicated to one of Willie's children, I remember now. But, you know, I remember that more easily than I remember the pieces themselves.
How interesting. Are they published?
Yes, they were published, and they're now out of print, along with practically all the other over 100 works that I have written.
Well, this, of course, is because you have done so many things, you always lose track of certain aspects of your career. You have told me that many a pianist has played your works and you yourself didn't even hear the performance or the recording. Am I right?
Right, yes.
Would you tell me that story of Rachmaninoff and his variation on Parade, one of your very important works?
Well, it came to my mind because one of the piano playtimes was based on the Brahms Paganini variations. Mm-hmm. And I'd forgotten that, too, by the way. But it did recall to me that many years ago, just before Rachmaninoff wrote his Paganini
Rhapsody
on that theme, I come to see him one afternoon. And during that afternoon, I played a few things for him, and he was interested in Parade, which was the first American work which Toscanini ever played of an American composer. That he did in 1931 with the Philharmonic. And Rachmaninoff said, play that. Can you play that piece for me? I said, oh, yes. As a matter of fact, it was originally a piano piece. So he said, play it. So I played it. So he said, play it again. So I played it again. And again, he asked for it. And then we talked for some other things. We had tea and a few other things. And he said, you know, before you go, would you play that piece for me again? So I played it again. I must have played it 11 times that afternoon. I never understood why he asked for it. I was flattered because I thought, yeah, you must like it. Mm-hmm. But anyway, 6 months, 8 months go by, and Rachmaninoff goes abroad. We hear that he's written a rhapsody on the theme of Paganini. And he came back, and I heard the premiere performance. It was phenomenal. But while the 20th variation was going on, I heard the whole bass was the bass of my Parade. Now, I was so delighted because there's no greater compliment in the world than emulation or imitation. And so when I spoke to him over the telephone the next day, congratulate him on the performance, he said to me, "And how did you like the Chasins variation?" And then I realized that he had done it entirely deliberately. I didn't. How could I know? I thought it might have been, you know, subconscious, which can very often happen.
Wonderful to know that it was deliberately done, and it's an extraordinary story, and again, shows another aspect of Rachmaninoff's character, and we always think of Rachmaninoff as this austere man who never smiled, but you obviously knew him in quite a different vein.
He had a fabulous sense of humor. Marvelous. His favorite entertainer was Jack Benny.
And his favorite pianist was
Joseph Hoffman.
Joseph Hoffman.
My teacher, my master.
Your master. You call him your master, huh?
Yes, indeed.
And you have never really gotten over the impact, but nor did Rachmaninoff or Gudovsky, of this man's playing, who was a student of Anton Rubinstein. Now, Anton Rubinstein, in Hoffman's eyes, was unbelievable. Now, Anton Rubinstein, though, said, "When I hear Liszt, we are all nothing." So think of what must have the source been like.
Yes.
Is it diluted each generation?
Well, you see, that's just what you said is fascinating to me, David, because it's the one thing which substantiates very often what might be an old-fashioned opinion of mine, that kind of greatness has gone from the world. When Hoffman laughed at me one evening when I told him that I had been so overwhelmed by his performance of the Schumann Fantasy, for instance, and he looked at me and he said, "I feel sorry for you that you never really heard the Schumann Fantasy played as Anton Rubinstein." He said, "We were babies, we were children, we couldn't touch him. It's too bad.
And think of it, because the Schumann Fantasy was dedicated by Schumann to Liszt. So maybe Rubinstein said to a student of his, "Oh, you never heard Liszt do the fantasy."
Right.
Well, this is such a fascinating topic. And, yes, of course, we will never have this cured, because there is no recording, thank goodness, of either of those two masters.
Thank goodness.
Yes. Well,
you mean they would
just
they might
in, Abram,
be so
just,
destructive.
Just in case. Now, you are a pianist of more than merit. Although you would never put yourself in the Hoffman class, you studied with Hoffman. And your scherzo in C-sharp minor is quite fabulous, and we want to hear it. What do you have to say about this interpretation, Chopin, or maybe your dealings with this work via Hoffman?
Well, whatever I have played of Chopin is enormously influenced by Hoffman's performance of these works. And it had to be, because when you once heard him do something, its originality, the individuality, the conception was so overwhelming and so convincing that you could never think about it in any other way. And sometimes it got too much so. And I think you remember, in speaking of pianists, I wrote about how sitting with Rachmaninoff in Gudovsky's box at a Carnegie Hall concert, it was a Saturday afternoon of Hoffman's. Hoffman had played the B minor sonata of Chopin. After which Rachmaninoff turned around very sadly and very slowly and very seriously, and he said, "Well, there goes one more piece out of my repertory. I shall never, never play it again." And he never did. And later I said to him, "Well, why do you feel that way, Mr. Rachmaninoff?" And he said, "Look, that's the music itself. There's no other way to play it when you hear it like that. And who can do it but Joseph? Nobody." He said, "Perhaps Anton Rubinstein played it that way or more greatly, but I never had the opportunity of hearing it." And he said, I will not try it again. You can't. Nobody can. There are many, many pieces of Chopin which I felt exactly the same way about, and I never brought them to Hoffman. I should have, but I couldn't. I couldn't bring the E minor concerto. Mm-hmm. I couldn't bring the Chopin F minor concerto. Mm-hmm. I couldn't bring the Andante Spianata and Polonaise, for instance. Mm-hmm. And I wish I could say that about many great pianists who should have brought them before they tried to record it to Hoffman, mm-hmm, because they sound like, well, innocent, naive pupils, mm-hmm, compared to Hoffman's playing of it on the 50th anniversary recording, which, as you know, is now a historic document at the Metropolitan Opera House.
Yes, indeed.
There's the living proof. Fortunately, we haven't, so one doesn't have to sound like such an old-fashioned fool. Just say, go and listen to it, that's all.
Then now let's listen to Abram Chasins, pianist, in Chopin's third scherzo in C-sharp minor. Chopin's third scherzo in the hands of my guest, Abram Chasins, a performance just packed with ideas in every phrase, so original and so totally thought out, free and yet structural. Abram Chasins had not heard this in 20 years, and he said that he's still happy with it, but it was one of the few things that he had ever really been totally pleased with. And this, again, is that terribly difficult thing of the intention and the realization. And after we realize these commercial messages, we will be back with more discussion with Abram Chasins. My guest is Abram Chasins. His biography should be written, his memoir should be written, because he has had one of those magic lives. In a way, you have said that no one has ever been luckier than you.
That's
what do you
right.
mean by that?
Well, a great opportunity of encountering so many remarkable people, legends in their own time. This was a great piece of luck. There's nothing else I can say about it. And I did have incredible friendships, and I tried to write about it and about them. But somehow or other, it's been difficult, personally difficult,
yeah.
and sent me back to my analyst three times. And if I ever do it, I don't know. It'll certainly be nothing more than memoirs, and I think it was named, actually, by Bennett Cerf, now that I think of it. But I think that's too personal. I think if I did anything, it would be more like Now That I Think of Them, and them being the people
yes.
who... I tell you, I have had the great luck of knowing. I won't even mention them, because if I mentioned them, it would not alone sound like inexcusable name-dropping, but then I might get 1,000 letters saying, you don't dare not write about these wonderful people.
Yes.
So I want to spare myself that.
But frankly, Abram, I don't want you to be careful. I want you to spew this out, because very few people have known and been intimate with so many of the great figures in music, and so many of your stories are indescribable. The story when you played your own piano concerto in Vienna and you discussed it with Freud. These are things that must be written about. Your story just today on Rachmaninoff was exciting. Think of all the things that you know about Hoffman. He himself didn't write memoirs, nor did Rachmaninoff. There's no pianist that did not benefit from knowing you as music director of WQXR and from your just fantastic knowledge of music. Now, we're going to hear very shortly a Brahms Rhapsody, the third, yes, but was Brahms in Hoffman's repertoire?
Now, curiously, that's again a marvelous question of yours, because Brahms, although Hoffman loved Brahms, he was conditioned by the whole Rubinstein school that was very much involved in the Wagner-Brahms
yes.
idiocy, that is, that incredible musical war between their disciples. They admired each other enormously, as you well know, but their disciples found a great deal to fight about, and somehow or other, Hoffman got dragged into this. So with Rubinstein, he never studied either of the Brahms piano concertos, you know, or had them exemplified or illustrated for him. So he came to Brahms finally quite late, and then he played the smaller works, with the exception of the Brahms-Händel variations, which he did absolutely unbelievably.
Now, when you studied the three Rhapsodies, of which you have a recording of, did you bring the Rhapsodies to him?
I certainly did.
What happened?
Well, he was marvelously helpful, as always. He loved them very much, and at that time, he said, you know, I've always liked the G minor, but I think I'll learn the other two. Mm-hmm. Just like, although he knew Scriabin awfully well, he never learned any of the sonatas until I brought both the fourth and fifth to him. Then he learned them.
So your master, indeed, had benefit from knowing you.
Well, benefited is hardly the word. I was just a much younger person.
Yes.
And, well, Hoffman, you see, was this child prodigy. It was quite natural for him to cling to a repertory which he knew terribly well, and as he got busier and busier, especially as head of the Curtis Institute, and then in his personal life, I guess learning new pieces was... he had done quite enough of that in his life.
Is it true that he had a hard time learning because he had learned often from ear?
I'm not sure of that. I'm not aware that he had a hard time learning. I just know that he didn't put himself through it very
yes.
much. That I know.
Of the three Rhapsodies of Brahms, we're going to hear actually the last piano piece Brahms ever wrote. Am I right?
The
Rhapsody in E-flat, which in a way harkens back to his love of Schumann. Let's hear Abram Chasins, pianist, in the third Rhapsody of Brahms.
Thank you.
the Third Rhapsody of Brahms in E-flat, played by my guest, Abram Chasins, and made at really the cradle of the LP right in 1948-49, over 30 years ago. What a wonderful thing the recording is, because this shows, and you haven't heard it for so long, this shows such passion, such verve, and that great tradition that you are talking about.
Well, what I'm most thrilled about is that the LP era was in, and we were able to make records like this. Think of what we would have if the recording had been invented just a century before.
Think of it. My goodness.
My goodness, yes.
Now, in that Brahms Rhapsody, you had many things that one would say is a deviation from the text, and yet it is so authentically pungent. People don't play the piano anymore with any ideas, and of course I'm categorically saying this is a generalization, but you understand what I am saying. You doubled certain things when you thought it was necessary.
Well, the deviation, and yes, David, may I say, is always meant to heighten, yes, the obvious hope and intention of the composer. And no composer was free from the moment in which he didn't quite realize everything that, yes, he wanted,
yes,
on the page at that moment.
Now, this question I wanted to ask you because, you see, you not only are a pianist, but a composer. And certainly, if I played the next piece, which we are going to hear, your own fairy tale, and I had something different from the score, and it was effective, you wouldn't be mad at me, would you?
I would be intensely grateful to you.
Oh, we will now hear, not by me, unfortunately, but by yourself, Abram Chasins' own performance of his fairy tale. Abram Chasins playing his own fairy tale for piano, and that was a work composed in the 1940s, I believe. Is that right, Abram?
Yes. And at the end, it's very unromantic because the lover and his girlfriend get into a fight and she kicks him downstairs.
I love that middle section, though. The middle section, they're doing very well together, though.
Oh, yes, they're, yeah, doing fine.
You know, your works, of course, are very difficult texturally, very difficult to play.
But not difficult to hear, I hope.
No, never.
As a matter of fact, I'm one of those old-fashioned composers who tonality and all those things that have...
But it's coming back, of course.
Ah, so it seems.
Yes. And after this message, we will come back with more discussion with Abram Chasins, and we will hear him playing Chopin's Impromptu in F-sharp. This is David Dubal, and I am back as your host with my guest, Abram Chasins. Abram, Chopin is close to you as he was to Hoffman. What is his secret that within every generation, no matter who is not in and who is out, Chopin remains played always?
Because of his essential poetic precision and fantastic harmonic genius, yeah, and absolutely individual treatment of the piano, which belonged to no other composer.
No one has ever gotten tired of this output. All of his works practically are played and all over the world. Today he is expanded as the most popular composer, not just, of course, in Poland, but in Brazil, and he's the favorite composer in Japan. He has, this Polish patriot, a kind of universality, doesn't he?
Yes, of course. I think that belongs to every one of the greatest geniuses, too.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think it's the popularity of the piano, which is also made for Chopin's fantastic presence. And, you know, he's absolutely on every series, every program, every...
What's the most difficult of the, beside the etudes, of Chopin's works for the piano, in your opinion?
Well, it's hard to say because there are so many different kinds of difficulty, David. I think perhaps the 24 etudes, the mm-hmm. Opus 10 and the Opus 25,
the preludes
might form the most technically difficult,
yeah,
if you ask. But, of course, it's very simple, comparatively simple and poetic works like the Berceuse or the Barcarolle, which are in many ways far more difficult.
Yes. Well, this Impromptu is very difficult. Not only does the musical values get deep, but that finger work is so demanding.
Well, it's a Chopin piece.
Yes. Chopin is a virtuoso composer, and we will hear our virtuoso Abram Chasins in the performance of the F-sharp Impromptu of Chopin, the second of his four Impromptus.
Four, yeah. Thank you.
extraordinary performance indeed of the F-sharp major impromptu of Chopin in the hands of my guest Abram Chasins, who has been so kind as to come talk to us today. And next week he will return in part two. Abram, thanks for coming.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to the next session together.
This is David Dubal, and I thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.